Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Camera Wednesday. In episode number 4, we're gonna take a look at the internet. So let's get started. So question comes to mind, what is it? In simplest sense, it's a very simple thing. It allows you to transfer data from one PC to another PC anywhere in the network. That's all it is. It was created as an R&D tool. Now there are some conflicting reports whether it was created for military or R&D. And military was not expecting you to use the internet as a, you know, weapons of mass destruction. So suffice to say, R&D still was the main thing. And as you see this system, this at one time used to host the whole of World Wide Web. Basically at that time there were only few computers in the system. And this was created at the Sun Collider. Yes, that super collider that we have was the birthplace of internet also. So, and it was in 1990s, early 1990s. So it also had web browsers and things like that. So let's dive into it. So how does it work? You have to understand, there are many steps or layers, if you can, to the internet. One primary layer is that you can only remember names of things. You can't remember the numbers of things. So there has to be an index. We generally call that domain name server. So what does it do? So computers like numbers and we like words. So there has to be an indexing, and that's the first layer of internet. After that, we have second layer, which is server. Now servers can be thought of that as a data bank. It stores all the data. That's why internet doesn't go down if, you know, person you are talking to, you know, stops its computer. An email is stored in the servers if when the recipient is not online at the moment. So now you have to understand that it's non-centralized. This is an internet map created by Google, and as you can see, it's going everywhere. There is no like one central node that internet connects it, and internet heavily relies on these puppies. What are these? It's called undersea cable. Basically, all of these cable, each of the cable can easily support terabytes per second. Now, 100% of internet goes through this. Satellite has a very little margin that goes through it. Although that might change after the advent of SpaceX satellite internet service. But suffice to say, all the internet runs through this. If any terrorist activity somehow manages to break any one of the cable, it can cripple an entire nation. And I'm not joking. Like, these things are literally national security level thing. So, and they're idiotically expensive. So how do you get it? First thing comes into your mind is like your country. Now these countries do not allow YouTube and things like that. So you might be in a country that simply doesn't allow you. You can't have internet if that is the case. And second is your ISP. Your company might decide, you know what, like how Verizon decided to throttle the internet. Now sometimes company can go much further and flat out block sites that they don't want you to see. And you might say, okay, I'm gonna use VPN. Country can directly block it. Country can simply say, if VPN service is allowed in their country, because you have to pay for it, high quality ones specifically, China, it won't go for you, it will go for the company, and the company don't want to take a risk. They're like, yeah bro, cool, no internet service in your country. So unless your country allows it, you cannot have good, reliable, you know, something that you can count on. You're not gonna have it. So country and ISP, these are the two layers that allows you to get internet. So what after that? So how it comes to your PC? Now we have many steps to get actual internet to your actual home. Now your country allowed it, your internet service provider allowed it, then how the heck it reaches to you or your mobile phone. Old systems used to rely on phone line. Phone line also used to do dial-up, but somebody figured out how to create another channel in the same cable. That's why they didn't need to lay down extra cables, and they got very high speed, like 5 to 10 to 25 Mbps speed. And phone lines have been quite a primary source of internet for quite some while. Then came the cable TV, and it was already there, but you know, popularity wise, cable TV was like sending data through the same cable that goes on to your television. So these two things were like kind of old school at this point, and now the latest technology and latest kid on the block is the fiber line. Now this is the flat out the fastest that you can have, flat out. The undersea cables are also optical fiber. So if somebody allows you to directly connect to that, you well, you are going at gigabytes per second or petabytes a second. So suffice to say, fiber is the fastest you can get. Then we come to wireless option like 3G, 4G, 5G. 5G is under construction right now, so we're gonna have it in next 2 or 3 years. And be mindful, wireless also has a very bad issue of latency. Pings on this system is ludicrously long. And then you have satellite. It is generally good for rural communication, or you know, you are on a ship or things like that, so you're gonna rely on satellite communication. Now, how do you judge which one to buy? There are 4 criteria that you can judge it on. First is cost, of course. Like, you might have a better service provider, but it costs too much, you're not gonna buy it. Then comes the speed. Obviously, you don't want to wait for, like, you know, your 1080p video to take 2 to 3 hours to load up. So obviously you want speed. Then comes the coverage. Let's say I like this company, Act Fibernet. It was flawless in Bangalore, but I can't have it in here, my current location. So coverage also matters. Even if 3G and 4G says that it covers your area, you might be so far away from the antenna or the transmission tower that the signal strength is so weak and you get a very slow connection. So coverage also matters. And then last but not the least is bandwidth. Now you might say speed and bandwidth might be the same thing. No, they're not. For example, Jio gives you right now 2 gigabytes per day. And at a very high speed, like I can easily get 20-21 Mbps on my mobile sometimes, but I have a connection that's 8 Mbps. So naturally you will think that 8 Mbps is useless, but it's it does not have any bandwidth limitation. They allow me full data access. So this, in a month, I can only go up to 60 gigabytes. My LAN connection, which has slower speed but have higher bandwidth, allows me to go upwards of 300-400 gigabytes. So as you can see, bandwidth also matters a lot. You might end up with a very fast internet, but then you realize, you know, if you tried even 1 or 2 downloading games from Steam library, suffice to say, you're gonna run out very quickly. So have these 4 points in your mind while you are choosing who is gonna provide internet to your home. So let's move on. So I hope you like this little presentation. Thank you for watching. I hope you liked it, learned from it. If you liked it, please like. If you didn't like it, dislike. Please comment, and if you're free, subscribe and press the bell icon. Thanks for watching.